إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها فإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أحييكم بتحية الإسلام وهي السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته So, in our last class, we discussed about the book of Imam al-Bukhari, Sahih al-Bukhari. We explain for you the real name of Sahih al-Bukhari. Also, what are the reasons why Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, he wrote his book Sahih al-Bukhari. And also we discussed the topic of Sahih al-Bukhari. Also, I explain for you the narrators that from the student of Bukhari that narrated Sahih al-Bukhari from him. So I think we stop here. The narrators among the student of Bukhari that narrated hadith from him. So inshallah today we'll continue from where we stop. So, adad al-hadith al-sahih. How many hadith Imam al-Bukhari he mentioning in his book? How many hadith Imam al-Bukhari he mentioning in his book? وَقَدْ بَلَغَتْ أَحَدِيثُ الْبُخَارِي بِالْمُكَرَّرِ 7,593. So the numbers of the hadith that Bukhari mentioned in his book with refutation is 7,593. This is with refutation. If I said refutation means maybe one hadith. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. أنا سكت. أنا أمري. لا شفاك الله. لا بأس عليك تقول إن شاء الله. Okay. If we say with refutation means maybe one hadith Imam al-Bukhari he will mention that hadith in many places in his book. This is refutation. Maybe, for example, hadith in Namal A'malu Binniya. Bukhari mentioning this hadith in many places in his book. So, if we count all the hadith in Bukhari from the first hadith up to the end, include the refutations of the hadith, so the numbers of the hadith is 7,593, but this counting according to Muhammad Fuad Abdul-Baqi. Muhammad Fuad Abdul-Baqi, he counting the hadith of Bukhari. When he count it, he found it 7,593 include refutation. 7,593 include refutation, but this according to Muhammad Fuad Abdul-Baqi. But according to the Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, according to the Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he said that the numbers of the hadith that Imam Bukhari mentioned in his book include refutation is 7,593. 7,397. So if you see these two numbers, it's difference. According to Muhammad Fuad Abdulbaki, he said the numbers of the hadith of Bukhari include the refutation is 7,593. But according to the Ibn Hajar Asqalani, like he explained in his book Hadith Sari, he said that is 7,397. What is the difference? Abdulbaki, he said 7,593. What is the difference?
One nine six.
So how we get this additional? Why Muhammad Abdulbaki he got this additionals? I hope you understand the differences. Yes, the differences. Muhammad Abdulbaki he mentioned 7,593. Include refutation. Imam Ibn Hajar Asqalani rahimahullah, he said is 7,397. The difference is 196. So how we got these differences? So the answer is because, for example, if you read Bukhari, he will mention the hadith. It's not of hadith. Maybe one hadith, he mentioned two is not for that hadith. For example, he said, Haddasana Abdullah ibn Zubair. قال حدثنا سفيان قال حدثنا يحيى بن سعيد الأنصاري عن محمد بن إبراهيم التيمي. Then sometimes, for example, he put ha means تحويل السند. تحويل سند means he want to mention another sanad of that hadith also. So after he mentioned the second sanad, then in the end he mentioned one matan. So show this hadith, it has two ways. So he mentioned for you all the ways of the hadith, two ways of the hadith and one matan. So according to Muhammad Fuad Abdulbaki, he counting this hadith as two hadith. But Ibn Hajar, he counting it as one hadith. So this is the difference. Why we get additional numbers in the counting from Muhammad Fuad Abdulbaki. I hope you understand. So this is the reason why. So, but all these numbers that we discuss according to Muhammad Fuad Abdulbaki and Ibn Hajar include the refutation of the hadith. Include the refutation of the hadith. But if not include the refutation of the hadith, so the numbers of the hadith of Imam al-Bukhari almost 4,000. So at least the refutation we have 3,593. All this hadith Bukhari refute it in another places. But if we remove the number of refutation. So the real number of the hadith that Bukhari mentioned in his book is almost 4,000. Almost 4,000. I hope you understand. So the hadith that Bukhari refutes in his book, almost 3,593. So means 4,000 hadith Bukhari, he didn't repeat it in his book. Only in one place he mentioning it. But 3,000 remaining hadith, 3,900, and he already repeat it in his book. So if we say the real hadith in Bukhari is just 4,000. But with refutation from this 4,000, we get 7,593. So also this number not include mu'allaqat. Not include mu'allaqat. Mu'allaqat means the hadith that Bukhari mentioned in his book without isnad. Without isnad, he deleted the isnad of this hadith. Just he said, Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, what is the numbers of mu'allaqat in Bukhari? So Bukhari, he mentioned hadith mu'allaqat in his book 1,341 means the hadith that he mentioned in his book without isnad, he deleted it isnad. He deleted it isnad. So it's 1,341. So this is the numbers of the hadith of Bukhari. I hope you understand. So now, intiqa'uhu li kitabihi wa inayatuhu bihi. How the Imam al-Bukhari, he choose the hadith. How the Bukhari, he choose the hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari from the hadith that he have. Because when the Bukhari, like I explained for you, Bukhari said that he memorized 100,000 hadith authentic and 200,000 hadith that it's not authentic. 100,000? Yes, that is not weak hadith, 200,000. He said he memorized 100,000 hadith authentic and 200,000 hadith that is not authentic, means weak hadith. So we already explained for you all the hadith that Bukhari he mentioned in Usul, in his book, which is not all hadith are authentic. So if we look the number of the hadith in Bukhari, like I explained for you, with refutation is 7,593. So but he memorized 100,000 authentic hadith. So how Imam al-Bukhari, he choose the best authentic hadith from this 100,000 hadith that he memorized? So this, it will explain for you that when the Bukhari, he want to write his book, or he want to write his book, he choose the best authentic hadith. So this is the reason why after Bukhari he finished writing his book, he submitted the copies of his book to some scholars of hadith in order to look to that hadith 7,000 that he wrote in his book. Like what Abu Ja'far al-Uqayli, he said, Lama allafa al-Bukhari kitab sahih aradahu ala Ahmad bin Hanbal ويحيى بن معين وعلي بن مديني مدين وعلي بن مديني وغيرهم. So after Buhari, he finished writing his book, Sahih Buhari. He submit one copy of his book to Imam Ahmad. You know who is Imam Ahmad? He's a great scholar in Hadith. He's Imam in Hadith. Also, he's very expert in the knowledge of Ilalul Hadith. Ilalul Hadith. He's very expert in the knowledge of Ilalul Hadith. Also, he submit another copy to Yahya bin Ma'in. Yahya bin Ma'in also, he's the great scholar in Hadith. Also, he's the great scholar in Ilm, Jah wa Ta'dil. And he know the situation and the conditions of the narrators. Yahya bin Ma'in. Yes. Wa Ali ibn Madini. Ali ibn Madini is the teacher of Buhari. Aliyu bin al-Madini. He's the teacher of Buhari. And Imam al-Buhari, he already gives strong recommendation to Ali ibn Madini. When he said that, Imam Buhari said that, I didn't see myself, I am small, in front of any scholar of Hadith, only in front of Ali bin Madini. This is what Buhari said. He said, I didn't see I am small in front of any Hadith scholars, only if I am in front of Ali bin Madini. So, yes, so it will show for you that he's very expert in Al-Mul-Ilal. Ali bin Madini, he's very expert in Al-Mul-Ilal. So also Buhari, he submitted his book to him in order if they have some observation, وغيره, and some Hadith scholars. So after Buhari, like what Uqayli said, that after Buhari, he finished writing his book, Sahih Buhari, he take copies of his book. He submit one copy to Imam Ahmad, another copy to Yahya bin Ma'in, and another copy also to Ali bin Madini and some scholars. Why he submitted these copies to them? Because he need, maybe if they have some observation, maybe if they will detect it from this Hadith 7000 that he wrote in his book, maybe if they will detect it, some Hadith that are not authentic. Because Buhari, he already trust this ulama, he know them, they are very expert in Hadith. So فاستحسنوا وشهدوا له بالصحة. All these ulama, they recommended the book of Buhari, and they said all the hadith that are inside Buhari is authentic, illa fi arwati hadith, with exceptional four. Means they agree in all hadith that Buhari mentioned in his book is authentic, only four hadith. So Buhari mentioned with reputation 7593. So if you remove four hadith, how many remain? Is 7589. So this show that all these scholars, they already agree with Buhari, 7000 hadith and 589 are authentic. Only they disagree with Buhari in four hadith. So this show that if these great scholars like Imam Ahmad and Ali ibn Madini and Yahya bin Ma'in, the rest of the scholars of Hadith, all of them, they agree with Bukhari in 7,000 Hadith and 589, they agree with Bukhari, this Hadith 7,589, it's all authentic, only they disagree with him in four Hadith. So this show for you, really, Buhari is very expert in Hadith.
Oh, the same Hadith?
Yes.
The same four hadiths individually, they agree.
Disagree. Yes, I want to show for you. This show to you that Bukhari is very expert. If this, like this ulama, only they will detect only four hadiths. So this show, indeed Bukhari is very expert in hadith. He's very expert. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. He's very expert in hadith. I hope you understand. But قال أقيلي أقيلي, he said that والقول فيها قول البخاري وهي صحيحة. And أقيلي, the person who narrated this story, but أقيلي said that regarding this four hadiths, that Imam Ahmad and Yahya bin Ma'in and Ali bin Madini disagree with Bukhari. He said the right thing, this four hadiths is authentic, like how Imam al-Bukhari said. You see, even this four hadiths, Bukhari said that this four hadiths that Imam Ahmad and Yahya bin Ma'in and Ali bin al-Madini disagree with Bukhari. He said the right thing is what Imam Bukhari said in this four hadiths. It's authentic, not like what Imam Ahmad said and Yahya bin Ma'in and Ali bin al-Madini. So this shows you what how Imam al-Bukhari, when he want to choose this hadith, he try his best to choose the best authentic hadith from the hadith that he has.
So Imam Yahya and Ali Madini says the four hadiths are not authentic.
Yes, and Imam Ahmad. Yes, and Imam Ahmad.
But
Qali said that what Bukhari said regarding these four hadiths is it is authentic, is the right, not what Imam Ahmad said and Yahya bin Ma'in and Ali bin Abdullah al-Madini. Okay. So Kala Abu Ahmad bin Adi, another scholar, his name Abu Ahmad bin Adi, he said that Sami'tu Hassan bin Hussein al-Bazzar, he said, I hear that Hassan bin Hussein al-Bazzar, he informed me, he said, he hear from Ibrahim bin Ma'qal. Ibrahim bin Ma'qal said that Sami'tu al-Bukhari, I hear Imam al-Bukhari yaqul, he said that ما أدخلت في هذا الكتاب إلا ما صح. I didn't mention any hadith in this book, Sahih Bukhari, only the hadith that is authentic. I didn't mention any hadith in Sahih Bukhari, in my book, Sahih Bukhari, only the hadith that is authentic. وتركت من الصحة كي لا يطول الكتاب. And I left many hadith authentic. I didn't mention it in my book because I don't like my book to be a big one. Because if he said he want to mention all the authentic hadiths that he know in that book, so it will show, it will make the book to be how many volumes? Many. So he need to summarize. Because if he wrote many volumes of the Bukhari, many people, especially now, they cannot read. So you see, now only 4,000 hadiths, but majority of us, we cannot read from A to Z. So how about if he mentioned all 100,000 hadiths? So this is the reason why he tried to summarize the book. He mentioned in that book only 4,000 hadith without refutation. If we count with refutation, is 7,593. So Bukhari said that I didn't mention any hadith in this book, Sahih Bukhari, only the hadith that is authentic. And I left many hadith that are authentic. I didn't mention it because I don't like this book to be a big book. So he summarized. So this show for you all the hadith that Bukhari mentioning, like he said in his book, is authentic. قال البخاري امام بخاري said that again اخرجت هذا الكتاب من زهاء 600,000 حديث. Bukhari said that I choose the ahadith that I mentioning in this kitab, in my book Sahih al-Bukhari, from 600,000 hadith that I have.
From 600,000?
Yes, 600,000 hadith that I have. Means 600,000 hadith that I have. So
he has more.
Yeah, he has more. So this show for you, when he want to choose, he choose it in very
meticulous.
Yes, particulars. Also, he focusing the more authentic than he choose. Also, this Bukhari, Sahih al-Bukhari, that we have it now, Bukhari, he didn't write it in just 1 month or 3 months or 1 year. No. He take long time. In order, why he take long time writing this book? Because he need the book to be authentic. So this is the reason why وَقَالَ Bukhari, he said سَنَّبْتُ السَّحِيحَ السَّحِيحَ فِي سِتِّ عَشَرَةِ سَنَةً وَجَعَلْتُ حُجَّةً فِي مَا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى. He said, I wrote or I write this book, Sahih al-Bukhari, within 16 years. 16 years, 1 6. 16 years. So he spent 16 years writing this book. 16 years, 1 6.
Including collecting the hadith, sir.
Eh?
Including collecting the hadith.
No, not collecting the hadith, just for writing.
For writing of this 4,000 hadith?
Yes. Yes, because if he choose like another wire, because he said if he choose any hadith, he already looked to the isnad and everything, he found that hadith is authentic, already fulfilled the condition of hadiths. So he like, I explained for you in Ulum al-Hadith. So before he put it in the book, he said he will take wudu, and he did rak'atayn in the Rawda in Medina to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if this hadith is authentic. Allah can allow him to write it inside the book. If it's not authentic, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to prevent him from writing that hadith in the book. So after he did these two rak'ah, he finished. If he hear some doubt in his mind regarding that hadith, so he didn't mention it. So when he want to write the hadith, he take long time.
Istikhara.
He take long time. So this is the reason why he spent 16 years for writing this hadith. For writing and editing for Sahih al-Bukhari. 16 years. So it's not easy. So this is the reason why, because he make the great juhud and his effort for writing Bukhari. So this is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make Sahih al-Bukhari, his book, the best book after Quran. The best authentic book after Quran al-Kareem is Sahih al-Bukhari, like I will explain for you. So, it means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gave him this in order his book, because everything cannot happen without the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you see, if his book is well acceptable and more authentic, this is the bless from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Bukhari, because Bukhari, he cannot make it.
His process.
Yes, he cannot make it, but Allah is the one who make it for him. So because anything that we did in this dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's the one who make it for us, make everything easier for us, and he's the one who give us knowledge to do that. If he didn't give Bukhari knowledge, how he can did it? And also after he gave the Buhari knowledge, if he didn't give the Buhari time and he make everything easy for him, how he can write the Sahih Bukhari? And also if he didn't guide him to the authentic hadith, how he will choose? So this is the reason why I said Allah he make. I hope you understand. Okay.
So all the hadiths are written in Medina?
Not normally. I didn't know actually all of them in Medina. Maybe it will be like that. Maybe. Or maybe he will maybe did two rak'ah in Rauda, but not immediately he read the hadith. Maybe he traveled to another country, he already did two rak'ah. Maybe he traveled to another town, maybe he write there. But this show for you, when he said that some of the hadith really he writing it in Medina, but we cannot set all of them because he didn't explain to us. But what he said, any hadith that before he wrote it in the Sahih Bukhari, he did two rak'ah in Rauda. So if he he get comfortable in his mind for that hadith, so he write it in the book. If not, so he left the hadith. It being he saw the hadith is authentic. So maybe after he did that istikhara, maybe immediately he wrote it, or maybe after istikhara, maybe he traveled to another town. At that town, maybe he make the decision to write it.
So he's always in Medina?
Always between Mecca and Medina and remaining town.
How long for the hadith collection?
Eh?
How long for the hadith collection?
Oh, hadith collection, when he started collection the hadith?
Yes.
Yeah, because maybe this is the post class to attend. We explain since Buhari he's still a child, he started collection the hadith from the ulama since in his town Bukhara. Yes, since before he became a matured, he started narrating the hadith from the ulama of his town in Bukhara since he's a kid, until after he collect the hadith from his ulama in Bukhara, then he traveled to Mecca together with his brother Ahmad and his mom for when he reached 16 years. Then he traveled to Mecca together with his mom and his brother in order to perform the Hajj. So after they finished performing the Hajj, then he requests permission from his mom that he wants to stay in Mecca in order to continue studying and collection the hadith. So his mom, she returned back together with his brother to Bukhara, and they left Bukhari in Mecca continue collection the hadith. But before he came to Mecca, he already started collection the hadith since before he became a matured in his town in Bukhara. So the time that Buhari started collection the hadith is very early, before he became a matured. I hope you understand. But this 16 years that I mentioned for you now means the years that he spent in writing Sahih al-Bukhari, not for the collection. You understand me? Not for the collection, not they started the collection. Just only the years that he spent for writing Sahih al-Bukhari is 16 years. Because before he write the Sahih al-Bukhari, he already collect many hadiths. So this is the reason why he said he memorized 100,000 hadiths. Authentic. So you see, then from this 100,000 hadiths, he choose the authentic hadiths. And another way he said he choose Sahih al-Bukhari from 600,000 hadiths that he have. So this show for you, before he writing the Bukhari, he already collected the hadiths. So not means he takes 16 years for collection the hadiths, no. This is more than 16 years. But this 16 years just the years that he spent when he started writing the Bukhari. Because we explain for you that the reason why Imam al-Bukhari, he wrote his al-Bukhari. The reason is, among the reason is, one day he attended the majlis of his ustaz. His ustaz Ishaq bin Rahuya. Ishaq bin Rahuya said to the student, his student, including Bukhari there, he said to the his student, if we can find one of you, he wrote a book of hadith. That book he mentioned only authentic hadith inside. So from that time, Bukhari, he take the intention to write Sahih al-Bukhari. Okay. So qimatul kitab al-ilmiya wa sana ulama alay. So how the scholars recommending the book of Bukhari, and what is the status of the book of Bukhari if amongst the books of Islam? What is the status of the Bukhari, Sahih al-Bukhari, among the books of Islam? And what is the recommendations that the ulama given to book of Bukhari? So now I'll mention for you the status of Sahih al-Bukhari among the books, within the books of Islam. Within the books of Islam, also how the ulama recommended the book of Bukhari. Okay, qala Imam an-Nasa'i. Imam an-Nasa'i, he said, you know who is Nasa'i? He have Sunan an-Nasa'i, Abu Abdurrahman an-Nasa'i. He said that ما في هذه الكتب كلها أجود من كتاب البخاري. He said, all this book that we have, all this book that we have in hadith, you cannot find any book that is more authentic if you compare with Sahih al-Bukhari. Means we cannot find any book that is more authentic than Sahih al-Bukhari. Means the book of Bukhari is the best book, is the more authentic book if you compare it with all the books of Islam in hadith. All the books that they wrote in Islam regarding the hadith, so the book of Bukhari is the more authentic. Means what in Nasa'i means, all the books of hadith that we have, if you compare all the books of hadith that we have with Sahih al-Bukhari, so Sahih al-Bukhari is the more authentic. So this show for you the status of the book of Bukhari. Means the Sahih al-Bukhari in the books of hadith, it will come in the first rank. You cannot find any book that is authentic or more authentic than Sahih al-Bukhari. Means Sahih al-Bukhari is the best book in hadith. I hope you understand.
If Imam an-Nasa'i already over, if Sahih al-Bukhari is the best book or the most authentic book of hadith, why Imam an-Nasa'i still wrote a book?
What Imam an-Nasa'i wrote?
Yeah, still a book, Sunan an-Nasa'i.
Yes, because not all the hadith Bukhari he mentioned in his book. You understand?
Yes, but so some part of Sunan an-Nasa'i, the hadith is classed as do'if.
Yes, this is the reason why Imam an-Nasa'i, his book, he didn't take promise that he will mention the authentic hadith, all authentic hadith in his book. He write his book with, inside the book you can get authentic, you can get Hassan, you can get weak hadith, because he didn't take a promise. Only Bukhari and Muslim, they took promise that they will mention the authentic hadith in their book and they fulfill the promise. But Tirmizi, Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, they didn't take that promise. They didn't say that I will mention it in my book, All Authentic Hadith. Just what they did, they bring the book, they bring the hadith in their book as in order to explain the ahkam sharia. So include this hadith, we can get a authentic, we can get a hasan, we can get a da'if. And what they do, they mention for you hadith with isnad. So this is left to you. If you take, you have to go and search the isnad in order to differentiate. But Bukhari, he take promise that all the hadith that he will mention for you in his book is authentic, and he fulfilled the promise. So this is the reason I say this is great mistakes. Some people said sihahu sitta. They said sihahu sitta means six authentic books. This is a mistake. They say sihahu sitta, six authentic books. This is a mistake. Because Tirmizi, Abu Dawood, Nasai ibn Majah, remaining four from six books, they didn't take promise that they will mention them for you, authentic hadith in their books. So if you said Sihahu Sitta, the six books authentic, so you already say something that the ulama, the authors of the book, they didn't say it. But if you said Sahihaini, Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, you are right. Because these people already agree, these two Imams, Bukhari and Muslim, they already take promise that they will mention the authentic hadith in their books, and they fulfill the promise. Okay.
Can we know the sequence of the book written, the dates, which book is written first? Like, for example, is Sunan Nasai written before or after Sahih Bukhari?
Yeah, it is. Some books we can know, but some we cannot sure. But regarding the example that you mentioned, Nasai, yes, it's after Bukhari. Yes, because he came after Bukhari. But like some of them, Ibn Majah, maybe he wrote his book before Sahih Bukhari. We didn't know, because in the Ibn Majah you can get many isnadul ali that you cannot find it in Bukhari. It means what isnadul ali means? Between Ibn Majah and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, only few people that you cannot find that in Sahih Bukhari. You understand? So yes, Imam al-Bukhari, he passed away before Ibn Majah, but we are not sure if he wrote his book before the book of Ibn Majah. And also, Imam Ahmad is before Bukhari. Also, Muwatta Malik is before Sahih Bukhari.
But they live in the same period?
No, Bukhari, when the Bukhari was born, Malik already passed away. Bukhari was born 194 after Hijrah. 194 after Hijrah, Malik passed away 179. So how many years difference? Malik passed away 179 after Hijrah. Bukhari was born 194. Almost 15 years, like that. After Malik passed away with 15 years, then Bukhari was born.
Why Sahih Ibn Majah is not famous,
Ustaz? Don't say Sahih Ibn Majah, Sunan Ibn Majah. Because Ibn Majah, he didn't call his book Sahih. Because he's not very famous, because the remaining books, they have a lot of fawa'id, means, fa'idah, fawa'id, that you cannot find it in Sunan Ibn Majah. And the remaining books are more authentic than Sunan Ibn Majah. I mean this Kutubu Sitta, like Sunan Tirmizi, Abu Dawood, Nasai, are more authentic than Sunan Ibn Majah, because in Ibn Majah you can find many hadith mawdu. Yes, he has many hadith mawdu inside. But why the ulama put Sunan Ibn Majah in this Kutubu Sita? Because you can get some new power in Sunan Ibn Majah that you cannot find it in remaining books. So this is the reason why the ulama added Sunan Ibn Majah in Kutubu Sita. Because you can find some hadith in Ibn Majah that you cannot found it in other books. So this is the new faida. So this is the reason why the ulama add Sunan Ibn Majah. But in terms of authenticity, so the remaining Kutubu Sita are more authentic than Sunan Ibn Majah, because Ibn Majah, we have many hadith mawdu'at inside. I hope you understand. So this is the what Imam Nasa'i said. Then Qala an-Nawawi, Imam an-Nawawi, he said, ittafaqa al-ulama rahimahumullah, all the ulama, if we said ulama, all the Muslim scholars, all the Muslim scholars, they agree, the ijma, ittifaq, they agree, أن أصح الكتب بعد القرآن, the more authentic books after Quran, Sahihaini is Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim. So we know that the Quran is authentic book. All the thing that in the Quran is authentic. So the more authentic books after Quran is Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. This is what Imam Nawawi said that. He said, وَتَلَقَتْهُمَا الْأُمَّةِ بِالْقَبُولِ, All the Muslim Ummah, they already agree and accepted the Bukhari, the Muslim. All Muslim Ummah, I mean Muslims. Yes, I will explain for you. All the Muslim Ummah accepted the hadith that Bukhari and Muslim narrated. Wa kitab al-Bukhari asahuma wa aksaraha fawaid. But the book of Bukhari is more authentic than the book of Muslim. The book of Bukhari is more authentic than the book of Muslim. Imam al-Nawawi. After he said that, after Quran, the more authentic books in Islam is Bukhari and Muslim. So between Bukhari and Muslim, which book is more authentic? He said the book of Bukhari is more authentic than the book of Muslim. The Imam al-Nawawi continued saying, وَقَصَّحَ أَنَّ مُسْلِمًا كَانَ مِمَّنْ يَسْتَفِيدُ مِنَ الْبُخَارِي. Imam al-Nawawi said that we already narrated from the authentic way that Imam al-Muslim, he benefit from Imam al-Bukhari, because Imam al-Bukhari is the teacher of Muslim. He's the teacher of Muslim. So he benefit from Bukhari. And when he saw his ustaz writing a book authentic, also he followed the way of his ustaz. So you cannot compare the student and his ustaz. So Imam Muslim, like what now we say that we narrated from authentic way, that Imam Muslim, he benefit from Imam Bukhari. وَيَعْتَلِفُ بِأَنَّهُ لَيْسَ لَهُ نَزِيرٌ فِي إِلْمِ الْحَدِيثِ. Also, Imam Nawawi said that Imam Muslim already agree and believe that you cannot compare any scholar in hadith with Bukhari. We cannot compare any scholar of hadith with Bukhari. So وهذا الذي ذكرناه من ترجيح كتاب البخاري هو مذهب المختار. He said that this what we mentioned now, that Sahih Bukhari is more authentic than Sahih Bukhari, than Sahih Muslim. This is the opinion of the majority of the ulama. Majority of the ulama, they say that. Only we have some ulama that say that Sahih Muslim is more authentic than Sahih Bukhari. Some ulama, but the opinion of the majority of the ulama, the majority of the ulama say that Sahih Bukhari is more authentic than Sahih Muslim. So, how we can know that? We already agree, like what Imam Nawawi said, that after Quran Karim, the best books in Islam after Quran Karim, or the more authentic books in Islam after Quran Karim, is Bukhari and Muslim. And we know that the majority of ulama say that Kitab al-Bukhari, the book of Bukhari, is more authentic than the book of Muslim. So how we can know that? Why the ulama say that Sahih al-Bukhari is more authentic than Sahih al-Muslim? That's how we can know. Why the majority of the ulama choose that Sahih al-Bukhari is more authentic than Sahih al-Muslim? Why the ulama, majority of the ulama, they choose this opinion? So, if you read Hadayu Sari, the book of Ibn Hajar, he mentioned many reasons that it will show for you really, indeed, the Sahih al-Bukhari is more authentic than Sahih al-Muslim. Sahih al-Bukhari is more authentic than Sahih al-Muslim. So, I will mention some of these reasons what Ibn Hajar mentioned for you in summary, because it's too many. And so I will try to summarize it. I will mention some of the reasons today, and next class, inshallah, we complete, inshallah. So, among the reasons that Ibn Hajar mentioned in his book, Hadayu Sari, why the majority of ulama choose that Sahih al-Bukhari is more authentic than Sahih al-Muslim, okay, before I mention the reasons, you have to know that Ibn Muslim by himself, he already agreed that Imam al-Bukhari is better than him in the hadith knowledge. And this is the reason why Imam Muslim, he already agreed that you cannot compare any alim of hadith with Imam al-Bukhari. And Imam Muslim also, like I explained for you before, he already said that Bukhari is the leader of the scholars of hadith. And he said he's the medical doctor of hadith. Imam Muslim, he said that, Tabib al-Hadith, medical doctor of hadith. If you have the hadith, you didn't know, like if a patient is sick, he didn't know where, what his problem, he will go and meet the medical doctor in order to diagnose him, to show for him this is the disease. So if you have the hadith, if the ulama of the hadith, they have the hadith, they try to search to know what is the illah of this hadith they didn't know. So if they bring the hadith to the Bukhari, because he's the medical doctor of that hadith, immediately he will detect it there. If he diagnosed the hadith, he detected the illah inside the hadith. So Imam al-Muslim, he already said that to the Bukhari. And he kissed the head of Bukhari. He said, "You are the leader of the hadith. You are the king of the muhaddisin." Also, you are the tabib, medical doctor of the ilal of the hadith. So from this, we can understand that before we mention point the reasons. Ibn the Imam Muslim, he already commented that Imam Bukhari is better than him. Is better than him. So Ibn him, he cannot argue that Bukhari is more knowledgeable in hadith than him. So if somebody is more, have a lot of knowledge than you in particular area, so if he writes something about that area and you write, you cannot compare what you write with what he's write. Maybe this person is professor in, for example, in engineering, and maybe you also only you have the you are just PhD holder in engineering, so you write the book is this professor, and you write a book in the same topic. So many people, they will say to what the professor write is more authentic than what, because he have a lot of knowledge,
research
better than you. So the same thing like here, Imam Muslim already commented that Bukhari is better than him because he call him Tabib Ilalul Hadith, the medical doctor of Hadith, Ilalul Hadith. So this in general answer. General answer is Muslim, he already agreed that Bukhari is better than him in the knowledge of Hadith. So another ways that the reason is, the first reason why Sahih Bukhari is more authentic than Sahih Muslim is like what Ibn Hajar mentioning in summary, أن الذين انفرد البخاري بإخراج لهم دون مسلم 435 رجلا. So before I explain, you have to understand that the narrators that Bukhari and Muslim narrated hadith from them. You know what is the meaning of narrators? Rawi. So the what that Bukhari and Muslim narrated hadith from them divided into three categories. All the narrators that Bukhari, the Muslim narrated hadith from them, we can divide these narrators, this what, into three categories. The first category means the narrators that both Bukhari and Muslim narrated hadith from them. You can find their hadith in Bukhari, also the same thing you can find the hadith of these narrators in Muslim. So both Bukhari and Muslim narrated hadith from this ruwat. So this is the first category. And this ruwat that both Bukhari and Muslim narrated hadith from them are majority. They are majority in the Bukhari and Muslim. They are majority. So the second category means the narrators that only Bukhari narrated hadith from them, you cannot find their hadith in Muslim. Only Bukhari, he's the only one narrated hadith from them. You cannot find their hadith in Sahih Muslim. So these are the second categories of the narrators of Bukhari and Muslim. Their hadith, second category, you can find their hadith only in Bukhari, but you cannot find their hadith in Muslim. The last category is the narrators that only Muslim narrated hadith from them. Only Muslim narrated hadith from them. Bukhari, he didn't narrate hadith from them. Means that the hadith of these narrators, only you can find it in Muslim, you cannot find it in Bukhari. So I hope you understand these three categories. So the narrators that now we discuss, only second categories and the last categories. But the first categories that the majority no problem about that, because both Bukhari and Muslim narrated hadith from there. So the thing that we discuss now, in order to know why Bukhari is more authentic than Muslim, we look it only to these two categories. The narrators that Bukhari, he is the only one narrated hadith from them. Muslim, he didn't narrate it from them. And also the last category is that the narrators that Muslim narrated hadith from them, Bukhari, he didn't narrate it. But the first category, first category that are majorities, we cannot discuss about that, because both of them, Bukhari and Muslim, narrated hadith from them. Okay, so now we say that أن الذي انفرد البخاري بإخراج لهم دون مسلم 435 رجلا. The numbers of the narrators that Imam al-Bukhari narrated hadith from them, that Muslim he didn't narrate it from them, is 435 narrators. 435. So these 435 narrators, you cannot find their names in Sahih Muslim. Only you can find their names in Sahih Bukhari. 435. So these 435 narrators, you cannot find their names in Muslim. Only you can find their names in Bukhari. Okay. So المتكلم فيهم بالضعف منه نحو 80 رجلا. So from these 435 narrators that Bukhari, he's the only one narrated hadith from them. Muslim, he didn't narrate it. So from these 435, from them, the narrators from them that ulama, some ulama said they have some problem, and it's only 80 narrators. Only 80, nearly 80. Means from these 435 narrators that Bukhari mentioned in his book, that Muslim he didn't mention them at all. He cannot find their names in Muslim. So from this 435, 80 of them, some ulama, they said 80 of them, they have problem in terms of memorization. So means that from 435 minus 80, also 355, means that 355 that Bukhari narrated from them, that Muslim didn't narrate, they are all authentic. But 80 that Bukhari narrated from them, Muslim he didn't narrate from them, some ulama said they have some problem in terms of memorization. So I hope you understand this. Okay, so we come to Muslim. So والذي انفرد مسلم بإخراج لهم دون البخاري 620 رجلا. The narrators that Imam Muslim narrated hadith from them, that Bukhari he didn't narrate it from them, only Muslim narrated from them, is 620. So this 620, you only found their names in Muslim. If you check this 620 narrators, you cannot find their names in Bukhari. I hope you understand. Okay. So المتكلم فيهم بالضعف منهم 160. But from these narrators of Muslim 620, from them, some ulama said 160 from them, they have problem in memorization. They have problem in memorization. 160 from this 600. So you see, in Bukhari, how many? 80. And in Muslim, how many? 160. So doubling of Bukhari. So this show for you the book that only few of the narrators, ulama, said they have problem is more authentic than the book that ulama said many of them they have problem, because in Bukhari only 80, the ulama detected only 80 narrators. I hope you understand. But in Muslim, the ulama detected doubling of what they detected from Bukhari. So this show for you, the book of Bukhari is more authentic than the book of Muslim. So I think this is the first reason we stop here, because if we enter another reason, so maybe it will be more complicated for you. So this is enough for us for today, inshallah. So next week we continue with mentioning for you the reason why Sahih al-Bukhari is more authentic than Sahih al-Muslim. So any questions regarding what I teach you today?
If Imam Nawawi realized that Imam Bukhari has a more authentic book than Imam Muslim, why he prefers wrote Syarah Sahih Muslim rather than Syarah Sahih Bukhari?
This is according to his desire. Maybe he like the book of Muslim, and maybe he see the book of Muslim is so easier for him for Sheikh than Sahih al-Bukhari. Or maybe he have another reason why. But he already agreed that Imam Nawawi already agreed that the book of Muslim is Bukhari is more authentic than Muslim. But in the Sharh, maybe he choose Sahih al-Muslim for other reasons. Maybe he like, by his nature, he like Muslim. Or maybe it's easier for him for Sharh than Sahih al-Bukhari. Or maybe another reasons. Or maybe somebody request from him to did Sharh for Muslim for him. You understand?
Or maybe he likes the
hadith. Or maybe... Another, maybe many reasons. Yes. But not sure that when he chose Muslim and did share for Muslim, that he agreed that Muslim is more authentic than Bukhari. No. Because what he mentioned here, he said this is the majority of the opinion of the ulama that Muslim, Bukhari is more authentic than Muslim. And he said this opinion is the right opinion. I hope you understand. Okay, any question?
But in terms of hadith, hadith muttafaqun alayhi are the best, right?
Yes, if we say muttafaqun alayhi, like I explained for you in the ulum al-hadith, the best authentic hadith is muttafaqun alayhi in the first rank. Why? Because Bukhari and Muslim, both of them narrated this hadith in the same way.
Only for these two.
Yes. So if like Bukhari and Muslim agree in one hadith, this show the hadith is, yes, it's very, very strong.
Same way meaning same is not.
Yes, same way, same is not. Okay. Yes. Okay.
Is
when all the ulama agree? No. If in the muttafaq alayhi, normally this terminology is the ulama use it for hadith that Bukhari and Muslim narrated hadith in the same way, and they already agree both of them. This hadith is authentic in the same way. They narrated in the same way, like hadith in Namal Amalu bin Niyya.
So
it's like
the authority.
Yes, this is the terminology and the authority, yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Not means if you say hadith muttafaq alayhi, all the ulama, no. If they in the science of hadith terminology, it is in mustalah, if we said muttafaq alayhi, mean Bukhari and Muslim.
What about the hadith on Iman, Imam Ihsan, Is it both?
This is Sirah al-Muslim.
Oh, only Muslim?
Yes. Hadith is Jibreel.
Jibreel.
Yes, Muslim.
I heard that Imam Ahmad memorized hadith than more hadith than Imam Bukhari. Is it correct, sir?
Yes. Yes.
Memorized more hadith than...
Yes, he memorized almost alf hadith, means almost 1 million hadith.
1 million?
Yes.
How about Sheikh al-Islam, sir?
Huh?
How about Sheikh al-Islam? Sheikh al-Islam?
Who's, you means, who's, we have many Sheikh al-Islams. He's not like Bukhari and Muslim. He come, Ibn Taymiyyah, he's mutakhir, jiddan. He's mutakhir, you cannot compare him with Imam Bukhari and Muslim. Imam Bukhari and Muslim and Imam Ahmad, they are more, they have knowledge than Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah just, he followed it. He's not Imam like them. Also, Sheikh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah is Imam. But he could not come, you cannot compare him with Bukhari and Muslim.
In terms of hadith?
Yeah, in terms of hadith, and also in terms of many knowledge.
So, which one is better?
You cannot compare. Yes, no, we are not here in order to discuss this is better or this is not better. You have to divide that. Like Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim and Imam Ahmad, these are the mutaqaddimin.
Earlier.
Their era is more closer to the era of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam than the era of Ibn Taymiyyah. So the era that is so close to the era of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best era than the era that came after. Khairun nasi qarni summa allazina yalunahum summa allazina yalunahum. The best era is former era. This is what Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. Then the era that followed them. So Bukhari and Muslim and Imam Ahmad and in the third one, and Imam Shafi and Imam Malik. I hope you understand. So you cannot compare Ibn Taymiyyah who came 500 to 600 years after Hijrah. Like Imam al-Bukhari was born 194. Between him and Ibn Taymiyyah almost 600 years. So how you can compare them? How you can compare Imam Ahmad? Imam Ahmad, he passed away 240 after Hijrah. Imam Shafi'i passed away 204 after Hijrah. How you can compare him with Ibn Taymiyyah? These people, they are in nearest to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Their era is very close to the era of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have authentic hadith that show that their era is better than any era that came after them. Hayrun nasi qarni summa allazina yalunahum summa allazina yalunahum. The best people, the people that are in my era, then the people that follow them, then the people that follow them. So this is three. So Shafi'i, Ahmad, Malik, Imam Ahmad, they are in the third one. So you cannot compare their eras with Ibn Taymiyyah. And also the era that came after Ibn Taymiyyah, you cannot compare that era with the era of Ibn Taymiyyah. Yes, Ibn Taymiyyah is Sheikh al-Islam. He's a scholar, he's a great scholar. And he tried his best in order to return the people back to the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because in his era, many bid'ah, many things happened, many people, they didn't understand the right way. They didn't know the right way of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Many bid'ah, many things happen. The people, they didn't know the authentic knowledge. So Ibn Taymiyyah is like a mujaddid, a reform. He reformed the religion in order to bring the people from what they are doing to return them back to the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So for this reason, we see him as Sheikh al-Islam and a great scholar. I hope you understand. But of his knowledge, he followed the knowledge of these people. His knowledge is within the knowledge of Sahaba. He didn't go outside from their knowledge. He followed them. So this is the reason why he followed them. He called the people to follow them. So if you look, read all the books of Ibn Taymiyyah, like Majmu' al-Fatawa, always what he want to explain to the people, to follow the way of the previous ulama like Sahaba and At-Tabi'in and Atba'u At-Tabi'in, the ways of Sahaba and the ways of Malik and Shafi'i and Abu Hanifa and many previous ulama, previous scholars like Sufyan al-Thawri, Awza'i, many Salaf. So this is the hour of Ibn Taymiyyah. He followed it. Not he bring another way that is different with the ways of Sahaba. No, because he meet in his era people, they didn't follow the way that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he left Sahaba on it. Because Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he give a good tarbiyah to his Sahaba, and he passed away, he left Sahaba in the right way. So in the era of Ibn Taymiyyah, many people, they follow the wrong way. They left, they already lived the way that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he left Sahaba on it. So what Ibn Taymiyyah he did, he tried with his knowledge to did da'wah in order to bring the people back to follow this way that is the right way. So this is what Ibn Taymiyyah did. Not Ibn Taymiyyah, he create another way that is different with the way of Bukhari and Muslim. No, he tried to call the people to follow the way of Bukhari and Muslim and Ahmad and Shafi'i and Abu Hanifa and before then Sahaba and the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I hope you understand. So you cannot compare him and them because they are previous
Abu,
people.
Mujaddid.
Who?
Sir, every 100 years there will be a Mujaddid?
Yes, like came in the hadith. But this Tajdid is not. Yes, maybe in one era we can get two or three of them. Maybe this one in another part of the world, this one is another part in the world. Because, for example, in the era of Ibn Taymiyyah, we have many ulama that they did many things for Islam. In the era, we have Hafizul Mizzi. In the era, yes, yes. Also, we have Imam Zahabi. He's the student of Ibn Taymiyyah.
But Muhammad
Al-Wahhab? Yeah, this Muhammad Al-Wahhab came after that. He's in 18.
Can be one of the
majority. Yes, in his own part, mm-hmm. in Jaziratul Arabiya. Mm-hmm. And in the same time, we have some ulama also. In another place, they did Tajid also. So it's not, we said that only in one era, one. Maybe we can get more than one or two or three mm-hmm. in the same era. Maybe this one in some part of the world, this one in some part of the world. Maybe this one in this country, maybe another one in another place.
No.
For example, at that time, Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, like you mentioned, in Jaziratul Arabiya, for example. So at the same time, in Africa, we have some of them. Mm-hmm. You understand? Maybe in Asia also we they have. I hope you understand. Also, not the condition of Tajdid, you have to take safe and did jihad, no.
Oh, yes.
No. Maybe Tajdid in terms of knowledge, in terms of da'wah. Maybe the people, they didn't understand the real sunnah, and you come, you explain them the real sunnah, and explain them until they understand, they started. This is Tajdid also. Not the people, they think, if we say this Mujaddid, he must to take the safe, and go to jihad. No, it's not like that. Maybe it will happen, but it's not the condition. We have a lot of mujaddidun that use only tajid in points of knowledge. Maybe many people in this era, they didn't know about the hadith. One alim started writing and explain. So this is mujaddid also. I hope you understand. So it's not a short where we get only one mujaddid for each era. Also, it's not condition each mujaddid he must to did jihad for with safe, because we had different types of jihad. We have jihad in terms of knowledge, to come to the place, all the people that didn't know anything, they didn't know the hadith, they didn't know, you try your best to teach them in order until you bring them to know the importance of learning hadith. This is tajid also. Or the people, they are following the wrong aqidah. You come and start the da'wah until you teach them, you bring them back and they know the right aqidah. Also, this is tajdid. Okay, I think we stop here, inshallah, because I need to go back.